per second. What the heck? Okay, there we go. Watch page.
And I got it.
All right, there we go.
Okay. So now I should be able to try to mount this up here. Can you still hear me okay?
Hold on. I just got to do something here. All right. Yeah, I can hear you.
Let me try to set this thing down real quick, okay? Just bear with me for a moment.
All right, hold on. All right, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to switch over to me until you get yourself situated.
Well, that'd be great.
All right. How you doing, everybody? We're just going through a few difficulties on his end. I'm going to hang up with you off the phone here, so it doesn't echo.
Okay.
And you have to, do you have a headset that you can plug in? Or else I'm going to end up hearing myself the whole time.
I do not have a headset on me at this point in time. I should have had one, but I didn't. I thought I was just going to talk, like, you know, with the webcam.
All right, with the webcam. Can you get, like, earphones or anything? And just plug them into your microphone so it doesn't echo.
I can do that. Actually, I have one right here. Hold on.
Joe, how are you? Obsolete Nexus. I truly hope a lot of women purchase this, but I think the current gaming situation will see mostly male purchases for this particular game here. Joe, how are you? Hi, Rob. I'm going to miss this, but this forum is a great idea. Good luck to you, Mr. Daring, and his Kickstarter. That we will see how this goes. Oh boy. What's up, everybody? Everything will be fine, young boy. All right. You got us behind you. All right. As you can see, I switched over to Roger's cam, and you can see that we can see the board game. He's going to just get a headset so we don't hear myself echoing the entire time. All right. James, how are you? Uncle May, I know this sounds bad. We're dealing with it right now.
Okay, Rob, can you hear me?
Yeah. Right. I can hear you just fine.
I am going to shut a window.
Okay.
Okay, bear with me.
Mr. Gothica, how are you? Good man, good to see you. See 18 here watching already. Yeah, we just started. All right, that should be that. I'm making whatever adjustments I have.
Okay.
Spiral 9, how are you? I mean, that's about as good as you're going to get that that camera that you have, because you don't have a very good camera. And All right, so the way this is going to work, and I'm just trying to...
Okay. Can you hear me okay, Rob?
Yeah, I can hear you fine.
Yeah, like my head, it's coming kind of ratty through like my headset and all that, but or my speaker, I should have had my wireless headset, and I apologize. I should have had it ready. So
I just got to make an adjustment here.
There we go, maybe with this. I mean, how is it looking on your end?
There we go. All right. Now that he's all set, my sound is good. Uncle May, I get it. I should sound fine now.
Yes, it's actually a lot clearer.
Okay. I was just waiting for you to get set before I adjusted mine.
I may, just for everyone, I may have to hold this because it's just a little webcam. So next time, though, I'm sorry, I'm not fully prepared. I apologize. Set this down. Okay, if I set it like this, tell me, how is that? So I can just leave it as a static cam and just show you stuff as we talk.
Exactly. That's the way I would do it right now. I would just kind of just turn it to the places that you want to show things, and we'll be fine. If we can't see it, I'll make sure that I convey anything that anybody has to say. So let me get this started. I'm sorry that we're late. Usually you guys know I'm either early or on time. Now, what's going to happen here is Rodger is going to explain the game, and he's going to explain it in phases. So we're going to give this over to him. I'm going to switch over to his camera, and then I'm going to read any kind of comments. Now, after he gets done with the comments, then what's going to happen is you guys are going to you guys can ask any questions, and I'll relay them to Rodger, and then we'll go from there. That way we have it on tape, and it's permanently there. Okay, so Rodger, it's all your show.
Okay, I'm back. I plugged in some extra lighting. Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
I didn't hear what, I'm sorry, I hadn't done my headphones because I had to plug in some extra lighting. So I heard you say about the phases. We're going to go over that first?
Yeah, what's going to happen is I'm going to let you explain in phases because we don't want to overwhelm everybody. We want to keep things very condensed, packed, explain the rules. If you can show certain things on the board and what they do and stuff like that so everybody understands what's going on. And then okay. What I'll do is, after you get done with a particular phase, I'll ask everybody, do they have any questions? I'll let them ask whatever questions they have, and then we'll go on to the next phase.
That sounds great.
So it's all your show. Go ahead.
Okay. Before the phases, though, what I'd like to do is tell you the objective. I think that's the most important, aspect.
However you want to handle it.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just going to shoot by the, how to win, your victory conditions. So let me start with this, and I'm going to take the camera, if you don't mind, down here. These are your quest tables right here, and hopefully you can see that okay, right? Maybe you could tell me, Rob?
Yeah.
Okay. As you notice, these are called elder globes. Okay, there's a green side, which it represents purity. There's no evil right now in the dungeon. However, when you start Dungeon Crusade, you're going to flip these elder globes to red. There's three of them for the three quest tables. Okay, so when we load it up with monsters and the quest, there's evil in the dungeon that we have to eradicate. So the object of Dungeon Crusade is to win the game, you have to clear all the quest tables. Okay, and I'm going to show you, I made these little books. Can you see that okay where it says main quest? Okay, there's a main quest. So you're going to have all these little books right here.
like let's say main quests and side quests, depending on the scenario that you choose. So when you pull your quest cards right here, you're going to have like a little, you know, the title of it, some flavor text I wrote for you, and then how to set up the quest. And then when you get that done, you know, that's main quest. This is the main quest. You just simply put it right there in the quest table. You achieve victory by closing the books, by completing the quests. When you have one table cleared, for instance, say we did our side quest and our main quest, the books are cleared. You turn the Elder Globe to green, and then the heroes head to the village for celebration day. That's where you can restock on health potions, rest at the inn, buy gear, so on and so forth. After that, you're going to go back into the dungeon to quest table two, and it's going to get a little bit harder now. Again, same principle. You have to turn the Elder Globes to green by closing the books to a cleared status. When you have all of the quest books closed and all the Elder Globes at a green status, you've won that scenario for Dungeon Crusade. You lose Dungeon Crusade in two ways. If all your heroes are killed, or hopefully I can get this over here, maybe you could help me, Rob. You see over here the village right here, this terror track? Right here, if that goes up to defeated, you've also lost. And that's when the minions come into play, and we're going to get to that. If too many minions escape out of the dungeon, they're going to raise the terror level, and you're going to be defeated. So hopefully, and Rob, maybe you could tell me if that was clear, and hopefully everyone got that. That's the victory conditions for Dungeon Crusade. So I'm going to set this back down. Hopefully you guys can see that okay. I have like a little picture I'm looking on my computer. So let me explain. First of all, this is not a complex game. I made this. I don't really care for complex games because they don't hit the table that often. There's four phases in Dungeon Crusade. There is the upkeep phase, where simply in the upkeep phase, you have initiative tokens. You have six of them for the six heroes. What you do is you look at how the board is, where the monsters are, and what you want to achieve for that turn. And then you put initiative tokens on the hero cards. Now, there's some random events that could change those. Man, this is Dungeon Crusade. Anything can happen in this dungeon. So you place your initiative tokens in the hero phase. And I don't want to get too ahead of myself, but if you have any afflictions, the heroes can be afflicted, you have to process those in the upkeep phase. The next phase is the encounter phase. And this is, I really had a fun time writing these. You're going to come over to the encounter deck. You're going to draw an encounter card. For this one, and I guess all pictures are on this. I didn't take the easy route and just write that. I want to immerse you guys. Every single encounter card has a little picture. For instance, this one, the ravaged undead are attacking a certain hero. In this one, rats could attack. In this one, you're going to see the steps right there, hopefully. There's some loot down there, and you have to do some attributes tests because there's a slime that's going down there. And then you've got to see what's in the chest. Something bad, something good. All different kinds of encounters. Minions will spawn into your dungeon randomly. This one is this pertains to the minions about raiding. We'll get to that. So there's all these different encounters. New stock at the blacksmith. Here you found, you know, there's all different kind of stuff in encounter. But you get the you process the card, then you move on to the hero phase. That's the third phase. In the hero phase, yes.
All right, but let's hold right there. Is everybody following this so far?
Yes, please do.
So we're just going to wait for a second. It sounds like your fire alarm's chirping.
Me?
Yeah. Is that your fire alarm?
No, it's actually, I just took the headphones off. It sounds, I just heard it. What a prime time for that to happen. I apologize.
That's okay.
My.
Not a problem. David, you're going to handle any kind of questions while he's explaining everything. But the most important thing is I want to make sure that everybody's following along and has this so far.
Yes.
He sounds fine to me. Okay. Well, I mean, as far as the rules are concerned. Okay, go ahead. Nobody's got any questions yet, so.
Okay, perfect. Great. Yeah. So we got, you know, of course, we set upkeep phase, place initiative tokens. We're going to get a little more of that, but so you know. Then we're going to go to the counter phase, remember? Pull in a counter card and process it. And then we go on to the hero phase. This is where your heroes are going to move, and they're going to attack monsters. Remember the chambers down here, these little, you know, all your quest items right here, main quest deal with these. Hopefully you can see that. Or there we go. Main quests items are inside the chambers, and the champions of Dungeon Crusade are guarding those. They're safeguarding those. Your heroes have to get into these little chambers here with the doors and get those items back. That's what, you know, kind of, and you can do more inside the hero phase. Like, you know, remember I talked about mining? Over here, you can mine. You can smash open crates, open treasure chests. So that's, it's real cut and dry. That's what you do on your hero phase. Then the last phase is the monster phase. Any kind of minions that are on the board, the guardians, those monsters are going to move.
Roger. So,
yes.
When you move the camera, it gets real blurry. So if you can move it as slow as possible,
that'll help
everybody out a bit, or else everybody's going to end up, you know, going into static shock.
I got you. I apologize. I did not.
Okay. No, it's okay. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Okay. And so, again, and is the camera placed good, Rob? Is everyone, can you get a good shot of that? Does it look okay?
Good shot of what?
Of the board. You can see the board?
I can see one quarter of the boards, just over half. If you turn it to the right a little bit, you're right.
Oh. No?
There you go. Perfect.
Right there. Okay.
Yeah.
So that's really it. There's what I just described, that you have the upkeep, encounter, hero, and the monsters, and then you go back to the top of the upkeep phase. And then, you know, then you look at the strategies, and then you replace your initiative tokens. And that's how that works, quite simply. And then whatever else you'd like to go to, is there anything else that someone would like me to? And wait, I have to say something. Everyone, welcome to my home. I apologize, I always say that. So everyone, welcome, and I'm glad you're here.
David, how many players does this game contain? How many players? Can it go from one to what?
Rob, may I answer that?
Pardon me?
Rob, may I answer that about the heroes?
No, I said, how many players is this game?
Oh, you can play up to 6 players. Of course, okay. I built this, though. The important fact is, from the ground up, I built this to be solo. You can play this by yourself or up to 6 people.
Okay, great. And what's the average time of a game?
Someone just asked me that, Rob, and it's like this. Me and David, we like all-night slugfests, okay? If you want to have a super long game, there are scenarios that will do that, that have, if you could say it, see the main quest? If you load up those quest tables all with main quests, I mean, it's like an all-night battle royal, frozen pizza, Coke Zero-induced night. You're going to be there for hours completing the same quest. Okay. However, if you just want to have a quick game, and which, you know, I'm going to have this in there too. What you're going to do is you're just going to take side quests. And I pulled one of these tokens out already. But you're going to take your side quests. And basically what a side quest is, they're just kill and clear. So you're just going to go in there. If you just want a quick game, get in there and just, you know, beat up some monsters, level up, get loot, you know, and try some strategy, then you just want to load it up with side quests. So it's really, honestly, whatever that, you know, how you want to play it. But I would say for a short one, an hour to 2 hours is probably the shortest. You're not going to, there's no way you can play this in 45 minutes or 30 minutes. That's
okay. That's fine. Okay. Another question I have here. Oh, excuse me. I was just trying to slam down some dinner while I'm doing this. Can you cover the 6 character archetypes? Oh, excuse me. What character classes are there?
Oh, okay. Yeah, and I want to talk about this about the warfare. Okay? And let me grab my
Okay.
Yeah, this is actually
keep really in mind that at some point if you can get to the character classes.
I am. It's going to pertain to that. It's going to lead right into that.
And Dave, if you can answer some of those small questions, that way I can concentrate on ones that I really think that we may not cover or something like that. So with David checking online, that helps us out even more. So go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh, no problem. No problem. This is the land I made of Avalon. There's 50 locations.
And back that up a bit. So back it up from the camera, away from the camera.
Can you see that okay?
Yeah, can you back it away from the camera a bit so everybody can see the whole thing?
That's what I'm trying to do.
Down a little bit. There you go. Perfect.
Okay. So this land I made, what I wanted to do was this. You know, a lot of these games, you just have attack, or you have melee and range, right? That there's a stat. And what I wanted to do was kind of like reflect it like our world. If you think about it, you have karate and street fighting and jujitsu. And so I wanted to kind of bring that into Avalon. And so real simply, right here, there's six of them. Let me get to this. We're going to get to the hero classes, okay?
Sure. Go ahead. Take your time. Yeah.
See that? That's physical. There's physical warfare in this game. There's range warfare. Hopefully you can see these. There is arcane warfare. Okay? There's mind warfare, chaos warfare, and mythical. And this is why I did this. Let's take the warrior. Okay, can you see this card? Hopefully you can see that card there.
Which card there?
No. The hero card. We're going to get into the heroes now. The reason I did that was this. I wanted to make a dungeon crawl game where you can't go in there and just run a hero in and pull a Burke. You know, pull a Burke is, remember Aliens, how Burke ran away? You can't do this in this game. You're going to get killed. Mm-hmm. So the thing is, our warrior here, he's proficient with physical attacks, but in his secondary, his other hand, he's good with range. So out of those, you know, six, he has two of them. So just notice, I'm gonna glance by, but our warrior, proficient in physical and range warfare. Our archer is proficient in range and mind warfare. Our wizard is proficient in arcane and mythical warfare. Our rogue, of course, is proficient in mythical and chaos warfare. And our cleric here is proficient in mind and arcane, and finally, last but not least, fitting, the barbarian is strong with chaos warfare and physical. And this is why I did this. You have to true party build. That's what I think a lot of games are missing, and that's why I did Dungeon Crusade. For instance, if you send him in to fight a monster, he has an okay chance, right? But then again, if you take the wizard and the barbarian in together, look at that. You're covering chaos warfare, physical warfare, arcane, and mythical, and you got a fighting chance to kill that monster. That's why I did six different attacks, because, and plus it adds to strategy and tactics where you can think, okay, guys, wait a minute. You know, let's not send in like here, like the barbarian and the warrior, because look, they're both good and physical. You want to complement your party. So, you know, when you go in, you have a good chance of beating these monsters. So hopefully that answers all the archetypes. Someone asked, is it in a stretch goal, will there be more heroes? Yes, but there's going to be a book two and book three of Dungeon Crusade if this works. And I have those stories written already. So I would give you more heroes, different ones, maybe like a priest, a paladin. But I'd be careful what I release, because I have something planned for everyone for this. So hopefully, make sure everyone likes what I said. If they want to ask anything, please do.
All right. I did see a question there, just bear with me for a second. How long does it take to set up? Dave answered that, said 10 minutes, just under 10 minutes. So the type of attacks, but not specifically archetyped as the character per se. Okay, let me just make sure. Each class is better. Okay, Dave answered. Here's a question. How does it play with three people compared to five people? I mean, can you play it with three to five people?
Absolutely. Absolutely. If you had three people, you would, again, there's six heroes, right?
Right.
But it's simple math. Each person would take two heroes. And okay. if you play with five, you're going to have that one hero where you're all just going to, you know, join in and say, well, let's use this, you know, hero here to complement this. Mm-hmm. You know, like, so that's what you do. If you had four, you'd have two heroes where you'd have to just co-op and think, okay, we got these two heroes. And understand this. This is played with six heroes.
Okay.
Although, I could see someone trying to play it with four. You know, someone modding it to play with four. But right now, it's definitely six heroes.
Are you going to try to have, like, scenarios where you can have maybe two players, just two heroes, or four heroes, or any, you know, like a three to five, or a one to three? You know, just taking, being able to take a small number of heroes through the campaign? Instead of playing with all six?
Yeah, but then again, I'm going to show you this, and this is what I said, and what, and it goes along with what you said, Rob. This is a blank quest card. Can you see that? This card.
Hold on, I gotta get my. Oh, okay, yes, I can. The other one was on delay. Okay.
You know, if this funds, I own the Dungeon Crusade site. All of these quest cards are going to be uploaded, blank ones, for you to download, and you can create a quest. Maybe that. Listen to this. I want to. If there's anything I want to get across, there's like a banging in the background. Is that on your end?
There's a baby in the background?
No, there's like a banging. There's like a.
Oh, that's my dog eating.
Oh.
Sorry.
Oh, no problem.
Go lay down.
This is what I wanted to say. This system that I created is so robust, it's only limited by your imagination. So what you just said, maybe you want to create a quest called The Rescue of the Heroes, where you only start with three, and maybe in one of these chambers, the heroes are held captive and you have to get them out. You know what I'm saying? So you could create something like this. It's this system that I made, truly, I hope you see this, would it create whatever you want? It's only limited by your imagination.
There was a question here. Is there lootable treasure, and is there some that are keyed to certain damage type characters?
I'm sorry, say that. It was kind of bouncing everywhere.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is there lootable treasure, and is there some that are keyed to certain damage type characters?
Explain that a little bit to me, how you interpret that.
The way I'm taking it is, Is there treasure that is specific to certain characters?
Not per se. Here's some of the loot right here. Well, actually, yes. I guess you could say that, because now these are the common items right here. Can you see these?
Yes.
Okay. Like for here, this is just a common, and you know that this uses the tried and true, where you have common, uncommon, epic, rare, and legendary. But also there's a black level called an underworld artifact. Those things are like plain out deadly. We'll get to that. But you notice here, it says +2 to mine warfare rolls. So you could equip this on any hero you want, and they're gonna be able to, when they roll the, when if they have to do like some mine warfare for maybe like a defense, you would add +2 to that. It's a very easy system. I didn't want to do anything too complex for people. So that's what that would mean. So I guess you could say, but lootable. Can I touch on a really fun aspect that I'd like to share with people?
I just got a couple of questions here that people are asking. So if you can answer these real quick. Will the boards be rigid or soft vinyl?
Will they be what?
Rigid or soft vinyl, excuse me.
Will they be rigid, as in like like the board design? Will it be like a hard, like player board? Oh no, absolutely. It's going to be what I've been talking to the engineers over at Wingo, and this is what I came up with. And I told them, if anyone's familiar, Rob, you know, remember like Dungeon Quest, remember that from the 80s?
Yep.
It's going to be that kind of design that I said, and each of your panels here, the dungeon, it's going to be 12 by 12 inches. Mm-hmm. And that way, I brought that to their attention, because it can keep shipping down, and we can get it into a smaller box and keep shipping down for people. So basically, six panels, 12 by 12, game board type material with interlocking jigsaw, you know, edges, and you snap your dungeon together, and then there's a stretch goal. What's that?
You'll be able to change the dungeon, is that correct?
Yes, there's going to be a very early stretch goal where we're going to do a double-sided one. You flip it over, and there's a whole new layout with new quests, and down the road, more boards for you. You know, again, I'm...
Okay. Another question I got. What are the symbols on the left side of the board?
Those are simply just something that I thought of to put. It's kind of like they're runes, and it's just really for decoration, and it just adds to the thematic nature of the game. Okay. Simply put. I hope they like them.
Okay. Uncle May said, I like that Avalon has a world map. Does this mean that each location's influence what kind of encounters you have in the dungeon, or is that left up to the player?
Not per se. The map is, if you guys caught, and Rob, we got to link this for people. I also, which I could bring it over here and move the camera, I created the Avalon Adventure board game. Mm-hmm. And that's like, that's kind of like, figure it like an appetizer. That's for someone, again, like me and Dave, what before you even play Dungeon Crusade, well, you know what, can we do a camera shift real quick? Can I show you guys? Okay. Now I have to make sure, tell me, because I'm not looking at the computer. Can you see this little ward right here?
Yes.
Okay, is it perfect?
Yes, it's in range.
Okay. What you do is you take a hero, I'm not gonna pull a hero because I'm on headphones. You start up at Hope's Reach. You're not gonna play the board. All you're gonna do simply is put this board on your table, get your hero cards, and you're gonna be using the dice from Dungeon Crusade. And what you do is, I got my runes right over here. There's going to be runes scattered randomly all over the zones. If you notice on these, if you could see that, there's little green dots, yellow and red. These are going to be randomly distributed all over the board. Okay? I'm not going to take the time now. And what you have to do is you have to find the runes to shatter the – can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
You have to shatter the curse on the dungeon doors. So this is like kind of like, figure like an appetizer before you play. And then I wrote for, this was, whew, what did I write? There's 248 creative writings. And what you do is you do a little attribute test. I tell you a story. Say right here, we move to the ancient runes. See the ancient runes card? We would draw this card. And then you're gonna roll a D12. Depending on what you roll, you're gonna read the entry for that. And then you might do a little attribute test. The lower ones are usually bad. The higher ones, you're going to find treasure, maybe some loot. I really want to keep these a secret, but you could see I wrote tons and tons and tons. And so you get the picture. But they're fun little challenges. And so after you get all the runes, there's a green. There you go. There's a green, yellow, and red. You can find it. There you go. See the? Can you see all the runes?
Yes.
Okay, when you recover those, you're just automatically teleported to the village. Your heroes could be damaged. They could have some awesome loot. They could have gold. And then you're going to start the game with the condition that you're in. And so it's just again, a little, you know, appetizer to get you into the game before you play Dungeon Crusade. And it's fun to travel around and see what happens out here. And it's just a cool little game. So I did want to share that with you. So his question is, that pertains to out here. And yes, every little zone, I wrote specific things for, like Wren's Crossing, the Tower of the Maidens, Dungeon of 13 Moons. It's going to pertain to, I'm a little creative, guys, just a little bit. And I wrote everything to be specific to that zone. So we're going to go back to the dungeon, if you don't mind.
Yeah, just a quick question here, because I want to get this on camera.
Okay.
Does items and artifacts have a price written on the card? Can players sell them in the village?
Say that one more time.
Do items and artifacts have a price written on them on the card? And can you sell them in the village?
Absolutely. Yes, you can. Can you see the board? Wait, I'm going to answer that. Make sure. Can you see the board okay?
Over to the right a little bit more.
No, this way.
The other right. Yeah, keep going a little bit more. To the right.
I can pull back a little bit.
Okay. There you go. Okay.
Leave it.
Right there. Right there.
Okay. Perfect. Yeah. Let's grab a couple. Let me show you. Yeah, there's a whole economy system, and I wanted to share this with you. Let me grab some of these. Hold on. Yeah, I made a whole economy system in this game. Can you see these gold? Well, actually, these are plastic. But a lot of people, because we're going for a retro vibe, there's not going to be plastic coins. People have said we're going to have cardboard money, you know, kind of like the games of the past. So we're going to be using cardboard money. And again, it's just a player request. You want it? We're going to do it. So let's get to some weapons here. Let's take, we have this right here, Axe of 1,000 Deaths. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Okay, notice that's a high gold value.
Yes.
That's 1,000 gold. So you could, you know, of course, find this in the dungeon on a loot roll. We're going to get to loot rolls. Or you could buy this in the village. If you want, you could sell this. You know, say you just want to get something else, but it's only worth half the value, rounding down. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's how that works. And wait, why we're on the subject? I think people know my love for dogs. So I got a ton of them. Can you see Albus?
Yes.
There's Albus right there. Okay. And what you do is, so say your hero wants to sell it. You could give this to Albus. He runs to the village for you, sells it. He brings your money back. Don't you love it?
It's pretty funny.
Thank you. But yeah, there's Champions, Doomblade, Eternal Guardian. So right now I've made 187 pieces of loot in the game.
Okay. And will there be more if you hit certain stretch goals or something?
Will there be more loot?
Yes.
Oh my God, absolutely. Rob, you're talking to the self-proclaimed king of dungeon crawls. Are you crazy? No,
just making sure I didn't have this on camera.
Can I interject something real quick? Putting me in charge of this Kickstarter is like putting a maniac in a gun shop with a full stock of ammo. I want people to have content. That's what I'm all about. That's why I did this. So, okay, that's my little interjection.
There you go. All right. Let's see. Okay, let's see. Once you were done on the world map, you move into... Oh, David answered all that. Okay, great.
Wait, can I show you something real quick about loot?
Go ahead.
Please. As I said, there's starting weapon, which is, let's take this scepter. Can you see how that has a gray circle at the top? Mm-hmm. That signifies that's your starting weapon. Now, we're going to get to, all monsters have a chance to give you loot. Okay?
Okay.
We're going to, let's grab this guy right here. This is something, a key feature I wanted to show you. Can you see the skeletal archer?
Yes.
Okay. Do you see that little treasure chest with the number? Wait, there.
Yeah.
See, it says, like, what is that, plus 19 or what?
Yes.
Okay, this is what's cool about Dungeon Crusade. That's a very unique feature. You're going to take, when you kill the skeletal archer, you're going to take your d20. Mm-hmm. And this is called a loot roll. There's a chance that every monster that you encounter is going to be carrying loot. You roll a d20. If you meet or exceed that number, he was carrying loot. You go over to the loot deck and you draw yourself a card.
Oh, that's interesting.
But no, Rob, let me finish, my friends. It gets more interesting. So say you just killed that skeletal archer, right? And you're like, wow, this guy's going to carry some awesome loot, right?
Okay.
So you think you're about to grab a piece of rare epic, and you pull a card and you pull this. Junk. A helmet stuck in a skull. And of course I wrote, can you read that for the crowd if I hold it steady enough?
What a great helmet, but the skull is lodged in it and it won't budge.
I've created all kinds of junk loot for you. That's an underworld artifact. That's a big one. But yeah, there's a broken great axe. Hopefully you can see that. Mm-hmm. There's a chipped shield, another broken shield, wandering boots. Like, they're all wore out. They're junk. So my boots have stench. Those things stink. A children's toy bow. So you could find junk, a broken sword. So the thing is there's another one. So the thing is, you could find junk in here. You're not guaranteed to get loot every time. He might have just been carrying junk. But here goes, this is what I wanted to show you. And this is something, again, exclusive. Underworld artifacts. Do you see that black circle at the top?
Yeah.
Okay, this is Mace of the Blood Gods. I'm going to get to this. Just want to show you a few. Whoop, that's not one. Okay, Axe of the Black Angel. And then right here, Grand Staff of the Undead. Now let me explain something. You could be any level to wield one of these, but you have to consider this. And I'm sure if you're playing with people, they're going to tell you not to use this. Do you see the 16 right here with the skull? Can you make that out?
Yes.
Okay. What you have to do is, after you do your attack, you got to roll a d20. Because these things are so hellaciously powerful, they could consume a hero's soul and kill him instantly. And the thing is, you have to charge it with life force. Life force is XP. You know, like you get XP? Well, in this game, you get life force. And I could break out, I'll show you some life force chips. Life force is your acts of doing good for people, vanquishing evil. So my point is, if you're more than welcome to wield this, and look at it, it does 7 damage and that's in arcane warfare. So there you go. If you have to really think, you want to wield something that deadly because it could kill your hero, and you have to charge it with life force. So there's only a few of these. And if the merchant ever reveals this, he throws it out. It's out of the game. In every game, there's going to be three randomly selected pieces of underworld artifact. So there you go. That's how much loot. That's why I had to show you. I'm into loot.
Now let me ask you this, all right? Because what a lot of games do is they do. It's almost like soccer in a way. When you bring your kids to soccer, they give them orange slices and a juice box at halftime. Is this one of those games that if you die, somehow you go back to town and that person comes back? Are you dead when you die?
I wish I could bring the village word. No, let me tell you something. And I love these. I'm not going to mention names, Rob.
Because I'll be honest with you, Roger. Yeah. I think it's more fun when a game's hard, when you go into all that time to make a character, and you feel that there's some risk going through a dungeon. I want to feel there's some kind of risk. And I wonder how everybody else feels about that. Well, and no, Pete, I'm giving the guy the floor. Believe me, I could talk all day if I had to.
But
just one of the community being funny, as usual.
Can I tell you about death in the game?
Yes, go ahead.
If a hero dies, there's none of that. I know, and I love some of these games. I'm not going to mention names. You know, there's some of these games where the hero can go up and say, hey, bro, you're down. Let me help you up. And he just stands back up.
Yeah.
If you're killed in this game, your hero's dead. However, what you're going to do is you're going to take your figure, and over there in the village at the temple, he could be resurrected for 1,000 gold. But let me show you how I work this out when he's resurrected. You know, you have health and essence. Can you see my hero card? You got health up here,
yeah.
Of course, with the slider, and you have essence. Mm-hmm. When you resurrect the hero, you pay the 1,000 gold to the temple. And then you take the white die, the white D4, can you see the D4? You roll it. Whatever the result is, if say it's 3, he's gonna regain 3 health and 3 essence. On top of that, you roll the red D12 and the orange D12. Red is health, orange is essence. You roll it, and he gains that back as all also. If that does that make sense?
Okay. Yeah.
That's how that is. So it's kind of a stiff penalty, but you can bring him back. But it's not like you just don't go help him back up. You got to resurrect him in the village. Mm-hmm. How's everyone liking this? Is there anything? Do people, you know, are you liking what I'm saying? Is there anything else you'd like me to do? Please.
Well, we had a bunch of people that unfortunately had to go do something, but they said that you definitely have a backer. There were a couple of people that said they definitely want to back this. Now, here's the thing. You said that there's three levels that yes. A hero can go through.
Yes.
Is that the cap? Is that it? I mean, once you level up, there's nothing else you can do after that?
Yeah. You know what, Rob? And I did. I made it. You can go to level 3. And on Celebration Day, that's when you level to the next level. Because this game, you know, I wasn't, you know, trying to wield this huge game like, you know, a huge sword. There has to be some kind of, you know,
cap.
You know, like, you know, some uniform to this game. Mm-hmm. To do something like that, it would just throw it out. And actually, early on, I did have it. You could go to level 5. But the experience and the thing I want to give people is a self-contained thing. You pick your scenario, play for a couple hours, 3-4 hours. You can get to level 3. And then, you know, that's what it is. And I make no apologies for that because that's the experience I want to give.
Okay. All right. I was just wondering because, you know, if there's a campaign system and you automatically get to level 3 and you still have a whole bunch of campaign left, I mean, do you have that sense that, well, okay, this is as far as I can take this guy or it's as good as I can get him and I still have to fight all these unimaginable foes, should we say?
The experience we're at right now, even that you guys, we're just scratching the surface. Mm-hmm. Of what, you know, when you get to level 3, that's really, it's pushing the limits right there.
Because yeah, does it take a while? I mean, it's not just like, you know, okay, I'm level 2, okay, I'm level 3, and...
No, it's on Celebration Day. Remember we talked about how you complete the quests when you clear them? Okay, when you go to the village, if you have the life force, mm-hmm. and you go to the academy, you can go to level 2. And, you know, these are some level 4 monsters here. Can you see those?
Yes.
I mean, these are like, ooh, mama, these things are tough. Look at that beast of the faith. You know, a death knight. ogre chieftain, ancient, you don't want to mess with one of them.
Okay.
Let me. Yeah, there's regular ones, there's Queen of the Black Hand, but there's regular champions, and then there's elite. Or the regular champions have origins. I wrote origin stories from where they come from over in Avalon. And then there's the elite version, and those are really tough. Those have there's an elite, mm-hmm. denoted by the gold star. They have some really nasty abilities. So I wanted to let you know, champions, regular, and there's elites.
Okay, and the board size is 2 feet by 3 feet, correct?
Yes, however, I've talked to them at Wingo, if you could see my hand here.
Yes.
I'm referring to this as your UI board. Of course, your quest tables are here, the little combat thing is here, your cards. Mm-hmm. And what we're going to do is, I mean, this is the prototype, this is going to picture this being cut. And I recommended to have this in a tri-fold design. So you could fold it once, fold it again, put it back in your box. And then, of mm-hmm. course, your dungeon, 12 by 12, six panels, and then you snap it together. And that's just okay. Making it easier for everyone, for storage.
Let's see. Yeah, they said agree, David. Too big a size may put some people off. You don't know. I don't know. I kind of like it. The bigger the better, but that's me. I like things yes. big. How well does it play solo, someone asked. He already answered that. Pretty
built
much.
From the ground up.
He built a game strictly to be solo. But
And co-op. It's impossible to play this against someone. You know, like all these games where you have dungeon masters, you got to have a game master. This is impossible to play this way. It's that much built for co-op and solo play exclusively.
Olivier says, again, about Bride. Oh, I think he's having a conversation with Dave. They're having a conversation with David. Sorry about that. Can we get onto basics of game and combat? They want to talk about combat.
Yes. Wait, did you say basic setup?
A basic combat. How does combat work?
Okay, we're going to have to move some stuff around, and I'm going to have to get a token here.
Okay.
Bear with me.
Yeah, take your time.
Okay.
How many monster types to battle? Will there be standees for all of them?
Yes, as of right now in the base game, you're getting 18 minions. As you can, over here, you know, there's 18 minions. Right now there is 48 champions. And remember though, there's regular and elite. So, you know, there's 48 champions. And mm-hmm. then in the base copy, we're gonna give you 8 guardians. And that, I think we bumped that up though, from 6 to 8. I think we're now with, you know, doing the cardboard standee, I threw in 2 more for people. It says, you know, I don't know, because I'm Groovus and I like doing this for people.
Right. Okay.
So what we're going to do is I'd like to get down on the level to show you this. Let's try
right,
to look
do at. Do whatever you want to.
Can you see this?
Move things down. Move it down.
Can you see this room? Okay, right here.
Yeah. Can you bring the camera closer to it? Just that'll be fine. If you want to bring it closer.
Hopefully I can. It doesn't get too.
No, that right there.
No.
Is there a way to put something right there? Would be perfect, right there.
See, I have to hold it then. But
do you have a book or something?
Well, hold on, I can maybe find something.
See, look at the big brains on Rob.
Wait. It's one of my wife's candles. I hope she doesn't mind.
Yeah, she'll be fine.
You try to tell her that. Actually, you are the guy to tell her that.
Tell her everything I want. I'm here.
Okay. Can you see this little room?
Absolutely.
Okay. I really wanted to talk about the quest because I love these little quests that I did, and it sets up combat. Well, just know this. Here, let's just do this one. Like, can you see that card? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Main quest cards right here. This is the flavor text. There's your reward. That's the title. This is going to tell you how to set it up. Okay, so what we're going to do is when you go in these rooms here, like this room right here, these represent champions. Okay, these little, see level one, and there's, mm-hmm. Let me get a few more for you. Okay, you know, as the levels go up, so there's like a level one that represents a level one champion. level 2, level 3, and level 4. They all correspond to those champions I just showed you. The champions safeguard the items in the dungeon. Okay, so like for the one I just showed you, it's called Tools of the Trade. See the little hammer?
Yeah.
Okay, the thing about this is, and why it's fun, and this is, remember we talked about being random and surprises and whimsical?
Correct.
You're gonna take his little items here. That he's gonna. It's a quest, basically. You have to find these three items. Hopefully you can see all three of them.
Yeah.
The thing is, when you go into these zones, you're not gonna know where they're at because this is a blank floor. You see that? Don't you love the little skeleton guy I put it on the bottom?
Yeah. It's a little hard because it keeps focusing in and out.
Okay. So let's say when you set up a quest, you're gonna take okay. It's gonna instruct you, take the blacksmith's items that he needs, but then it's gonna tell you to take some blank ones and you're gonna shuffle them. Hopefully you guys you'll be like, I see now. You have no idea where these are at now, right?
Right.
Okay, so let's say that this zone right here we're in is called Pit of Darkness. In the quest, it's not in there. Okay, so let's just take one of these. We don't know where they're at, right? I shuffle them. Right there, boom, there's a quest. Can you see that little quest item?
Yep.
But same with the monster. Let me grab this. Same with the monsters. That when it tells you to set up monsters, it's going to tell you, okay, pull... you know, level 1 monsters, it's going to tell you to pull a few level 2. When you're level 1, you don't go over level 2. And see where it says empty?
Yes.
Okay, now check this out. It's going to tell you to shuffle them and then place one, we'll place all of them in the rooms instructed. That's my little spawning thing.
Okay.
You have no, now, you like that little sound, huh?
Oh, that was okay. Wonderful. After being up for 16 hours, yes, I want to hear sounds like that.
Okay. So check this out. Let's say our rogue is right. Let's bring some guys over here. So we have the barbarian, we have the rogue, and we have the wizard. Now, you may know, we have no idea if that's the quest item. We don't know if what monster that is. That could be, it could say empty. It's an empty chamber. It could say it's a level 1. Or it could be a level 2. That's what I wanted to give people. You're not going to know until you open that door and go in there and reveal it. So let's just reveal it. Hopefully it's a level 1. So that's what I'd say. No. Okay, see how it's a level 2?
Yeah.
Okay, you better have come in with some heroes because you're in for a fight. Because you guys are only level 1 and you got to fight a level 2. But let's just, for the demo though, I'd like to show you. Let's say that there was a level 1. Okay, so okay. And you're not allowed to reveal that quest item. You have to slay that champion before you can reveal that if that's a quest item. So you open the door. Let's say a rogue was real, let's say she was real sassy and she goes in here. Okay, we're gonna get into rallying. She's like, I'm gonna go in and fight that monster. Okay, so we know there's a level 1, correct?
Yeah.
We pulled the level 1 card, and it's a mass, can you say it's a massive viper. Remember how we talked about the 6 different warfare types?
Yeah.
Monsters in Dungeon Crusade have 3 of the 6.
Okay.
So what that's telling you is, okay, since she did not rally, see rally?
Yeah.
She didn't rally any other heroes. You can rally up to 2 others. She didn't rally anyone to go help her in this fight. She's going to be in this alone because you have to declare. So what we're going to do is we're going to come over here to the dice box, and this is going to be a fight with the physical, range, and chaos. So you know what? Hopefully, let's just do it. I'm going to move some stuff around. It just probably be so much easier.
Okay.
Okay, so let's get our dice here. Rodger, are people liking it? Or are they like, you know, do they want to ask anything?
Everybody seems interesting in it. Okay. Just keep doing what you're doing.
Okay. Okay, so say, can you see the dice box?
Yes.
Okay, where's our viper at?
Do you get a dice box with it?
That's my personal dice box right there. Okay. This is the official one. Look, Dungeon Crusade.
Is that a stretch goal to get a official dice box?
If a company wants to reach out and talk about one, I'd be up for it. Do people want a Dungeon Crusade dice box? If you want it, let me know. We'll look into it. Okay. As long as it does it, you know, it's not crazy expensive. Okay, so we can see our monster here, right?
Yes.
Okay, so our rogue went in here alone, and she's got to fight that thing by herself. He's strong in physical range and chaos. Okay. Now, it's over here on this side. What you're going to do is pull the icons. There's a little chart down here, but we're going to mess up the board. But it's important, I think, to see this.
Yeah, yeah. It's fine.
Can you see this?
Yes.
Okay. We have our physical warfare, we have our chaos warfare, and we have our range warfare, just like on the card.
Right.
Okay. What you're going to do is, you're going to see it has like the warfare, it says warfare on the back. Mm-hmm. You're going to shuffle these a little bit. Phase one, phase two, phase three, reveal. Phase one is going to be range combat. Phase two is going to be chaos combat. Phase three is going to be physical combat. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so here we go. Our rogue is, you know, in there. She's got a fight. Now, some of them, this is, oh, and see, this is a regular. There's no gold star. This is not an elite champion. You're just going to get the origin stories of where it comes from. Okay, so we're going to, the dice are going to probably knock him down. But we have our dice. And we're going to get into that. You know, I want to keep it simple. So you can roll up to a 2 to an 18. So we're going to roll. Okay, over here, range was in phase one, right?
Right.
We had chaos in phase two, and then physical in three. Now we got to look. Remember where's our card at? I'm looking for the rogue. Oh, right here. Okay. See her stats right here? Remember she's proficient in?
Yeah.
She's proficient in chaos. She can add a +2 to chaos. So let's see what happened. We rolled an 8 in the range phase. See mm-hmm. the numbers? See the 10, 1?
Yeah.
She did not beat that. Therefore, she's going to take 1 damage. We're going to come over to her card. And we're going to slide that down to, well, it starts out on 10. She took 1 damage. Phase 2, what did we have to exceed? 11 to 1, right? Or 11, 1 damage. Even with her 2, with 5, that's 7. She didn't do that. She didn't do it. She's going to take another damage. And then finally, in phase three, you know, she doesn't, now notice, she doesn't have any physical. She can only defend because she's not proficient in doing, you know, in fighting in physical. Mm-hmm. However, she rolled a 15. She exceeded what the Massive Viper did with 12. So she rolled a 15 that has a 12. She blocked that 2 damage coming at her. Mm-hmm. And then you go. Now, but. Well, it's going to get more interesting, my friend. Watch this. Let's go back a second. Okay, so same thing. We're going to go back. Let's just rewind, right?
Okay.
She has her friends over here. Actually, yeah. So she has her friends over here. Okay, can you see the room okay again?
Yeah.
Okay, same scenario. What she does is, okay, she has initiative token 2. She's going to go, you know, second. She says, listen, guys, we're going to go into this room together. We're going to fight. She's going to rally the next hero, who has 3. She pays 1 essence. See that? It goes down. She paid 1 essence to rally. And she's going to move. Opens the door, 1, 2, 3. Now, because she rallied, our warrior had initiative token 3. If I could find out where 3 went. Mm-hmm. But anyway, like if you know, he had 3, right? Of course, right after 2. And he's going to rally. He does not have to pay the essence cost because the rogue already did that. Mm-hmm. So now the warrior, and he's going to roll. We're going to get into movement. But now the warrior moves in. Finally, the warrior says, okay, well, the wizard, we're going to get you in here too. Let's fight. You're allowed. Remember, you're allowed up to 2 other heroes. The wizard had initiative token 4. Rally. He's moving in. Same scenario. Now they pull the monster card. Back here with the Massive Viper. I'm going to put this back, right?
Right.
Look at that. Our warrior can fight now in the physical phase and do damage. Someone's going to have to defend. They're going to have to talk about it like Wizard. You're going to defend in the range phase. And then finally our rogue will have, you know, can attack in the chaos phase. That's what I'm talking about true party building. You build a party, you go in and fight and kill these things. That's combat in a nutshell. Hopefully you liked that and you understood it. Hopefully it's clear for everyone.
Did everybody understand how combat works? Now, how long between, say you got six players, long does a person's turn normally take? Would somebody be waiting an amount of time?
No, what you just saw, that's like, you know, on your turn, you move, it's very briskly paced. You're not going to be sitting there like for 5 minutes. I'm talking under 2 minutes, minute and a half.
Okay.
It's not very long at all. There's nothing, what you just saw, you move. You know what, maybe the longest thing. See the treasure chest?
Yes.
Okay, so let's say that me and you are playing. Like, okay, Roger, I'm going to move my warrior and I landed on a treasure chest. Mm-hmm. You're going to come over here to the treasure chest and you're going to see the treasure chest?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to pick a treasure card. Boom. 1,000 gold.
Nice.
Or you could also pick something and it's going to be poison gas. You're going to lose essence, and anyone else in a quadrant around you is going to lose that. And just one more for you. And it's going to lead into something. My favorite game is Dungeon Quest from the 80s. I encourage everyone to go watch my playthrough. You could pick a swinging pendulum might come out of the ceiling. Mm-hmm. And then you have to do an attribute test. You know, you have to remember all the heroes have attributes, right?
Right.
But then check it out. That doesn't go away. Wherever that treasure was, you put the pendulum.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You have to put the pendulum token. Any hero, there's actually a treasure right here. If any hero going past that is going to have to do that same attribute test to get past the swinging pendulum. And wait, while we're on treasure, real quick, I'm 20 seconds, okay?
Okay, sorry.
Okay, there's 30 cards for you guys in here, okay? There's 10 treasure chests around this dungeon. There's 10 of them. 30 treasure cards. There's 10 cards that say they're empty chests. There's 10 cards that are kind of good to really awesome good. There's 10 treasure cards that are not that bad to really bad. You shuffle all the cards, and then you randomly deal 10 out. Again, whimsical, surprises, random. You never know what's going to be in your treasure deck, and that's one of the exciting things about Dungeon Crusade. And believe me, I have some exciting – hey, look at – who else in the world would give you this? Where is it at? Look at that. Oh no, that's the 1500. Well, anyway, there's a 2500 gold in there.
Okay.
And so, you know, and there's 2500 gold, and there's another token one that's Wall of Arrows. See the arrows coming out of the wall?
Yeah.
You got to do an etch. So I just want to show people that, believe me, I'm the self-proclaimed king of dungeon crawl games. This game doesn't convince you. I don't know. Then you'll take my crown, Rob. You can be it. I tried.
Okay. Real quick, Roger, can you explain can you go over to the village board, explain the village board, and I believe David asked, explain the village board next, and how monsters can raid it as well.
Oh, yes, yeah, that's a cool one. And actually, it'll lead into the patrol route system. And, oh, Robert, I just want to correct you on just one small thing.
Sure.
It was not the combat system, but I was really glowing about the patrol route system. That's
okay, yeah, sure, go ahead.
I'm sorry, our board's getting kind of a mess. I hope you don't mind. It's
Worry about it. We understand. You know, this is a big game to explain.
Okay. Maybe I should show you the mechanic for the patrol route system, because I think a lot of people were interested in that. And I'd like to do that, okay?
Okay, why don't you show the patrol route system and then go to the village.
That will lead perfectly into this. Okay. I always grab this guy. This is Elmo, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to put him – I'm going to have to move the camera. I apologize.
That's all right.
Okay, let me explain why I came up with this and what I've always wanted. And truly, this is something I've always wanted in a game, and now with Dungeon Crusade, I have it. How many people out there have wanted to put their heroes in a gigantic dungeon with monsters that are just roaming around while your heroes are creeping through it while monsters are randomly moving around you? I mean, to me, that's the heart of a dungeon crawl game. So what I did was, after years of this, we have a big grid here, right? Our dungeon is a grid.
What I did was I divided our dungeon into quadrants. There's 24 quadrants, four going up, six going across, okay? Within these quadrants, I'm gonna move the camera, and I know I'm gonna move it slow. Can you see that little skull pile?
Yes.
Okay, and you see like the lines coming off of it? There's, yes. There's an orange, green, purple, and a blue line. Okay. See our friend Elmo here? See, can you see him okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Please go, okay. So what it is this. You know how it sucks to think for the monsters in games? Like you don't want to do it. You want the monsters to have some kind of invisible AI. Okay, our friend Elmo here has a base movement of 2, meaning already he can move 2, and he rolls a d6 for additional movement. Okay, so you add 2 to this. So what I did was, what I just described, this is what I manufactured, and it's going to be in other games that I have tons of games I want to show you guys. This is what I manufactured. Can you see this?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, it's a D8, and the company I work with, there's 2 like blue skulls, 2 green, 2 orange, and 2 purple. This is for the patrol rat system. And I believe this is, to me, I think it's really a breakthrough in monster AI and to give people an unpredictable, whimsical experience. We're gonna roll. Okay, so Elmo rolled a 6, and he has a base movement of 2. That's 8, right?
Yeah.
On our patrol rat die, orange, he is gonna move 8 spaces on the orange patrol rat. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. He hit, if you could see that, you see Elmo?
Yeah.
Okay, he just went to, let's get the heroes out of here. They're ruining the show. Okay, he just hit, he has 1 more movement left. He's on a patrol route. He's on a spawn point. You take this, he's gonna go green now. He's gonna go this way. Unpredictable movement patterns, and just imagine this dungeon, you can make it as hard as you want. You want a few minions? You want a lot of minions? They move by themselves. Well, I mean, you got to use your hand. You'll never know where they're going to go in the dungeon. Now, we're going to get to the village right now. This is how you lose the game. The monsters, okay, when these guys come in, they're vagrant. Vagrant meaning they wander aimlessly. Mm-hmm. However, something can trigger them to, I'm going to shut the door here. Something can trigger them to become a raiding minion. And I hope I can get the board over here, get the thing over here. I'm going to try to move this because I want you to see this.
Okay. I got one quick question. If you got a whole bunch of minions on that board,
right?
How do you tell which one that you moved? I mean, does it get confusing?
No. This is, well, here we go. This is absolutely not. You know how the cardboard standees, the double-sided, you're going to get bases.
Yeah.
What you do is, it's this one here. Okay, here we go. Okay, so say Elmo is green, right?
Right.
Quite simply, can you see the green dot? Oh, wait,
yeah.
Right here? That's how you know how to keep track of everything.
Okay.
And then, you know, our wraith, we have a wraith, a blue wraith. You're going to know that it's the blue wraith. And then there's going to be a section for your monsters where you put your monster cards. They go from left to right, like you're reading a book. And that's how they're processed. Real simple. Is that clear?
Got it.
Okay. Now, I wish I could get over here to show you this, but I got stuff on it. Maybe I can. Let me explain over here. This is a very interesting mechanic right here. Can you see where it says raid difficulty?
No.
Let's see if I can. No.
Nope. Okay. You had it. Back a little bit. All right, right there.
Okay. How's that?
That's all right. Okay.
Okay. What you're going to do is before a game, the scenario is going to tell you raid difficulty 20, raid difficulty 10, whatever, right? What that means is on a minion's turn, you're going to roll the raid die. And what the raid die is, if that number, if the highest value for that number comes up, let's say we're playing with the normal is a raid value of 10, meaning if it's the highest number on a D10 is a 10, right?
Correct.
Okay, if a minion is a vagrant minion, a wandering minion, before you even move him, you roll the raid die. In this case, the D10. If a 10 is rolled,
you're going to put this on his card, signifying he's going to be a raiding minion. On that turn, he's moving towards the village. So basically what this is, Rob, is how hard do you want to make it? Do you want to make it where you just want to do quests, you want an easy time? You put your raid difficulty in 20, you're going to roll a d20. If a 20 comes up, it's going to be a raiding minion. You know, if you want to try this, here, you want something unplayable and they'll break the game, load this board up with 12 minions, put it on a raid difficulty of 4, and you're going to roll a d4. On a result of 4, those minions are going to raid the village. That's almost near impossible, but it's there if people want to do it. So that's right there, the raid difficulty. And if two minions, can you see the terror track?
Yeah.
As minions escape, it's going to go up. If it ever gets to, can you see the skull with the crow? It says defeated. If it ever gets to that, you've lost Dungeon Crusade and you have to replay it. You got to use better tactics, Sparky.
Yeah. Somebody asked, is there a magic system?
A what?
A magic system.
In the form of special abilities here.
Let's take out a wizard. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, we have special ability. This is, where's that one? She has disarm trap. Okay, like this, shadow dagger. And it's real, they're fun special abilities. Right here, if you pay the essence cost, you're going to roll a d6. And can you see the results? That way, so there is special abilities, but they're nothing difficult. And they're fun ones. I didn't want to get too complex with it. And wait, while we're here, see the little red arrow?
Right. Yeah.
Okay, what that means is after you use this, you've heard of tapping and exhausting. In Dungeon Crusade, you channel it. You turn this upside down. On the next upkeep phase, you unchannel it. So if you see a red arrow, like, okay, Rob's rogue, you know what? I'm gonna try to give it to this monster. I'm gonna spend the two essence. I'm going to use Shadow Dagger. You're going to roll a d6, and then that's the results. If you get a 6, you're going to hit them for 2 damage. After you're done using this, you channel it. On upkeep, you unchannel it. Simple. And then the wizard, yes, the wizard has a really good one. The cost is heavy, but check this out. This is Orb of Knowledge. And what this is you got to pay 5 essence, but what it's going to allow you to do is look at the top champion card. So like Orb of Knowledge, you can use this to look inside of a room before the fight so they know what kind of champion is on the top of the deck. So they have prior knowledge. And you know, and everything specific like this, this is a wizard ability. You're not going to find this, of course, on a rogue or an archer. It's specific to the wizard, and I created it that way. You know, Barbarian can do, you know, his thing that pertains to the barbarian. So in that regard, yeah, and I think he has chain lightning that he can hit all, if you're in a quadrant, like we talked about quadrant, any minions could be hit by that if he's adjacent. Oh, and there's no, like, you have to be adjacent to attack, just like in like Hero Quest. In Dungeon Crusade, you move left and right, up and down. However, you are permitted to attack diagonally. I hope that, go ahead, if you have any questions.
Yeah, does the village raid difficulty change during the game, either up or down?
Nope. You set that at the beginning, and that's how it is. But here's the thing. When you guys are creating your own scenarios, just remember, guys, this is what I call veritables. You know what? I want to create a scenario where it's a terror level of 7, but I want a raid difficulty of 20. You know, or maybe let's start it with a terror level of 3 and put it on easy, which is a 12, which of course you'd use a d12, and if a 12 comes up, a minion would raid. So hopefully that's clear, and it shows you how robust this is to create what you want.
Or maybe even it could go where once it hits terror level 6, say you're on raid 20, that it actually moves down. It can move down to 10.
Oh.
You see what I'm saying? You could change it any way you want. You have two visions.
Do you see what you're doing already? You're already creating a scenario. You're already creating something. Dude, there you go. Yes, you could do that if you want. But the way I'm going to give it to you is, you know, how it is, you guys are up to create whatever kind of adventure you want. That was paramount to give people that, to create and imagine and share this stuff. So hopefully I explained that.
Oh, you did. Okay, why don't you get on camera here, and what we'll do is we'll take a bunch of questions from the gallery here, and because you've already been talking for an hour and a half.
Well, say what? It only feels like 15 minutes.
Yeah, and we'll get you on here, and then we'll leave it open for you to answer any questions or any questions that anybody might.
Actually, I'm kind of porched. May I grab some water, sir?
Yeah, go ahead. I'll get this.
I'm going to set this back, hopefully, where you guys can see me. And oh, wait, Rob, I got to say something. Remember how my name is in the Dungeon Crusade thing,
yeah.
Roger? I have to say, I loved what you said on there, where you're like, you know, about someone said, like, when we were talking before, and you're like, this is Rob Oren, and tonight it's Painting with Rob Oren.
Yeah.
And you know what? I didn't mean it like that at all. It was just simply.
No, I didn't think you did.
No, the new one is simply Dungeon Crusade, Book One, Genesis of Evil. So that's going to be the new one. And I like that better.
Okay.
Wait, so if I'm sitting in that chair right there.
Yeah, you'll be perfect right there.
How's.
And from this point on, I'm going to Dave, I'll take the questions from here.
Let me see if
come on, I can't get this to do what I want it to do. Click there. Go ahead. You're fine right there. And then
but you know what I forgot? I got these headphones on and the cord's not gonna reach.
Oh, okay. All right,
Let me get a drink, actually, because okay. I'll be right back. Give me just a moment.
And I'll just read it as it goes. Everybody can look at my ugly face. But I am in HD. Let's see. I'm going to start with you, James. How are you, my friend? Good to see you today. Adjust the levels like Legends of Andor. Well, we'll ask him that as soon as he gets back. So what are you guys' thoughts also, you know, while we got you on here? What are you guys' thoughts of this so far? A lot of interesting aspects of it. I think the only thing I'd like to see the levels higher. That's just me. I like to always keep developing my character. It's kind of weird, you know, especially when you're going through and you get done with a quest and you go back to the village and you can go, okay, what can we get that'll make things easier? Because that one guardian was tough and we don't know what we're going to run into next. And you just like to see really, really, really tough, tough creatures.
Okay, If I unplugged these headphones, it would be bad?
Yeah, it'll be bad.
Okay. If
how it's okay as long as you're as long as you're sitting there, you can just leave it on the board. That's fine.
You know what? Wait, let's try something here. I'm gonna just move everything and hopefully. Okay. Let's see if we can.
I'm going to ask you some questions while you're doing all that.
Go ahead.
Can you adjust the levels like Legends of Andor? James asked that one.
And like what regard of changing the level do you mean? Like in what respect?
That's all he wrote, but let's go down to the next question and we'll give him a chance to clarify that a bit. How well does the gameplay tell a story? Do you come away from an adventure thinking, holy cow, event X, Y, and Z was amazing. Thank you, Jamstrap.
I'm sorry, I was trying to get this thing.
Okay, I'll say it again. Hopefully you can hear me. Jamstrap asked, how well does the gameplay tell a story? Do you come away from the adventure thinking, holy cow, event X, Y, or Z was just amazing?
Actually, the only, like, there's a, it goes, like, from here, if you can you see that?
Yes.
Okay, it's basically this. I wrote, like, a little story that sets stuff up, And then the quest cards will tell you a little bit of the story. Actually, I should read one for you, to be honest, if I may.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, let me try to get over here with you. And this is called A Mother's Request. Mm-hmm. Good, I have my other reading glasses on. I apologize. But it's okay. I don't know. Can you make that out from that or no?
Pardon me?
Can you read that from there?
No, I can't. Your camera's really, really hard to see.
Okay, well, basically it's this. It's the heroes approach a weeping mother, and she tells them that her child is deathly ill. And she wants you to retrieve a chalice. I mean, I wrote all these like little stories. And mm-hmm. so what it is she tells you there's a legend of a chalice that is broken in two pieces. And actually, it's right here. Right here. Can you see that?
Yep.
Okay, well there's two tokens also that it's in two pieces. And she tells you that the chalice is broken and it resides, I believe it was a Tomb of St. Viticus and Ogre's Lair West. So the pieces are in those zones, and you're gonna have to search the rooms to find the two pieces. Mm-hmm. And then you gotta go to the Well of Eternity, which is all the way to the east, southeast of the dungeon, and there's a well there, and it will mend the chalice and it'll bring the healing waters back to heal her daughter. But then there's monsters in the Well of Eternity zone, and you gotta clear it out. And then the well is untainted, and then you can mend the chalice and help her. So the thing is, I'm real thematic. I mean, you can see how thematic I am. That mm-hmm. so, and I don't want to mislead anyone at all. So if this is as much as it gets, all the quests have little stories that set it up, and mm-hmm. then the overarching, like for the scenario. But it's not. I don't want to think it's like a 5-page thing or you know anything like that. So
okay.
So it's like that. Hopefully that explains it clear.
Yeah, that's fine. Olivier says, I like the pool of action point system. A good way to do that game, a cooperative game, but is there another system so players may contest? I don't think I understand that.
I was trying to understand it too.
Yeah, I think it's David Jamstrat. Can you answer that? Hold on, let me just jump all the way to the bottom for some reason. I hate when this thing. What's this? My goodness. Okay, yes.
I'm going to try to walk over here with these headphones. I don't know if it's going to work or not.
David already answered that. Thanks, David. When will the game come out? I am ready to play. Chris asked that. Chris James?
How is that?
Once it funds, when will it come out?
Can you see me okay?
Yes, we can see you just fine.
That's the thing that a lot of people, I hate ruining my dungeon, god darn it. Okay, as I said, and this is what I tried to explain to people, and I've talked to the artists, mm-hmm. that the prototype's already made. I mean, they have, you know, Cameron Brown has already showed me a few pieces he's in charge of the encounter cards.
Okay.
So the thing is, guys, you don't have, see, the problem is with that, when you go, if I would have went with Dungeon Crusade to an artist or artists, could you imagine how long that would take to come up with concept art and, you know, to nail something down? What I did was, this was a hell of a lot of work, but I cut out all that concept work. What I told the artist, take my design, you know, take this, you know, Wraith, use your creativity, your imagination to make it like this. Mm-hmm. That cuts, and they've said this cuts the work down, the load down immensely because they don't have to, you know, concept art. I already have it right here, guys. And it's gonna be in that retro, you know, like late 70s, early 80s, early 90s, late 80s design, Dungeon Quest. You know, in that vein, like Warhammer Quest.
Right.
Dragon Strike. So it's gonna have that retro vibe going on, which I think is going to be really a nice exclusive look that's no one's doing.
Okay, David said that the Kickstarter, you're upping the date to March 2017, but there's a chance it might be earlier.
That's the thing. I want to tell people because, you know, I really did my homework, guys. You don't know how much I did my homework on this. And that's one of the biggest complaints is people getting their games late. And, you know, you see who I am. I mean, I don't want to upset anyone. I want to make friends. I want to make games for you. I've got, you won't believe what's in my head for book two. If you think this is something, you won't believe it. So the thing is, I want to be realistic. But you know what I'm going to say, guys? Yeah, it's March. Well, I said February. David probably moved it up to March, which that's totally fine. I anticipate this being done more sooner to get it to people. However, we are not going to rush this. This is going to be, you know, right as rain for people. I don't want to mislead anyone. So we're going to get it to you as soon as we can. And I anticipate a quicker ship date.
Yeah, especially since you're not going to have the miniatures in it. Right. Here's a great question. Rodger, please make your shipping EU friendly if possible. Can you
My friends, I've already done that. There was an outcry for that on the Dungeon Crusade on my Facebook thing. I spent 3 days for them because they said, you know, we don't want to pay this. I'm like, okay, you know what? Let me get on. I told you, I'm determined. When I do something, I don't stop. I just keep going. I called and called the good folks at Shipware, which I'm going to make an announcement right now to people. And Rob, to be honest with you, that's why I was late. I just hung up with Jason from Shipwire. They're going to be handling all fulfillment rewards throughout the world for us. So that's who we're partnering with. It's going to be Shipwire.
All right. Let's see. Did the feed loop? No, I don't think so. Avoid some issues. I'm just going down here. It's a pity not to have a competitive rule option. I know it's difficult, but it. Oh, hello. Did I lose you? David, are you there? Hello. Did I lose you? Roger.
Yes.
Oh, okay. I thought I lost you there for a second.
No. Did someone just say about competitive?
Yeah, they were wondering about if there was a way to put a competitive mode to it.
It's impossible. And here's the thing. There's so many. It's saturated with that. Again, and there's no offense. Down the road, I have some awesome ideas for that. But for right now, this is for my soloist crowd and my co-op crowd exclusively to give you this kind of experience.
Joe in Arizona said, I'd like to see character advancement too. The D&D adventure system of leveling with just two levels is unfulfilling, especially knowing how much more in real D&D is available.
Again, with this, it goes up to level 3, but again, I don't want to put it on the table. I wanted to do something with, like, we already know about Create a Hero, but I'm talking about something in the future that I've been talking to David about. I'll just say that there might be something to tell your story right at the start of the game. And I just want to leave it at that right now. But for right now, there's so much in Dungeon Crusade already that it would just be overkill.
Okay, great. It's nice to have a relevant power curve as you advance. Oh, okay, that's what Joe said. Let's see. Are there traps? Joe asked if there were traps.
Is there? Guys.
Hey, Joe.
You're talking to the self-proclaimed king of dungeon crawls. Is there traps? Tons. Yes. You're going to... Guys, look here. There's more over there. This deck is full of encounters. There's so much stuff in here. Good, though. Good and bad. I want to say something, too. I love the D&D board games. I truly do. But I think that they whittle away a hero's hit points. In Dungeon Crusade, there's no insta-kill. My encounter deck, I think when people hear that, they're scared off. There's some awesomely cool challenges I made, fun things. You know, attribute test. There's traps in here. Spike floors could come up on you. Pendulums you saw. There's a sinkhole there. Yes, there's traps in this game, but not overkill. Am I still there? I just got something on my screen.
Yeah, no, you're fine. You're doing
okay.
Fine.
Something came on my laptop. I don't know what it is. Okay, but go ahead. Hopefully they answer, yes.
Okay, this is how does your secret room system work?
Oh, I forgot. Darn it.
You can just explain it. That's fine. Go ahead.
Hold on. There's little tokens. When you set up, and we're going to get into that when we do part two of setup. Can you see this deck right here? What happened?
I just got to get you. Yeah, I can see it.
You know what? We got, no.
I want to do this for you real quick. I'm going to go back over. Hold on.
Okay.
Okay. Are you there?
Yeah, we're here.
God, my dungeon looks terrible. Please forgive it.
You're fine.
Okay, check this out here. Actually, whoever did that, give them a shout out. Tell them thank you.
James, you get a gold star for today.
Yes, you do. Okay. When you create, when you are setting up your dungeon, okay, you're going to have, I don't know if I can show you, I didn't show you, because everyone thought it was daunting. Can you see my, well, everything's on the table. Okay. All of your tokens fit very nicely inside of here. Okay. So just, you know, you get one of these extended ones, all your tokens will fit inside of here.
Okay.
Okay. This is another feature that, and they're in the encounter deck, and another little exclusive thing. When you're setting up your monsters, remember these little guys right here, are these can you see it, these tiles or the, yeah, you know, the tokens? You're gonna put these things down. Okay, it says secret room.
Right.
What you have to do is a hero, there's lock picking in Dungeon Crusade. I'm so glad you brought this up. The thing is, you don't just go walk into the secret room. You gotta pick the lock to get inside of there. Mm-hmm. How do you pick the lock? They're all different kind. See, like the little locks on there?
Right.
Let's see if I can grab one. See that?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's take this one for example. You want to get into that secret room because you want to draw one. Believe me, you want to draw one of these cards. Secret room. Mm-hmm. You got to pick the lock. This is what you do. See the green, red, and blue?
Yeah.
And let's grab this, okay? That represents these dice.
Okay.
What you do is you're going to have 5 attempts to pick the lock. So what you do is you get your dice box and you roll.
Okay.
Say we rolled a green 6.
Okay.
We set that aside. We got almost the lock done. So then, you know, we're not going to roll that, so we have 2 more chances, and we roll, and we're looking for a red 3 or a blue 2.
Gotcha.
Just say you got this, right? You have, mm-hmm, 5 chances to get that. If you do not do that, if you do not pick the lock, that room's locked. You can't go in.
So you'll never know what was in there.
Right. You can't. If you don't pick that lock in the 5th attempt, getting those numbers, your hero failed to pick the lock. However, if you do pick the lock, you could find it's an empty room. Mamma mia, 2,500 gold. See, I give you gold in this game. Yeah. That's going to be hard to get. So look at this, empty room, 600 gold, empty. And then there's some in here, empty, 1,500 gold. Look at that, pick 2 pieces of loot. You're going to go over to your loot deck. You're going to pick 2 pieces of loot. You found some loot in there. And then so on and so forth. So there's everything from like 200 to empty. I'm glad you brought that up, my friend. So I hope you like, that's lock picking. And the encounter deck, you're going to have to do, you know, lock picking in that too. It's going to tell you to grab that.
Is there any way for the barbarian to smash the door down?
No. Nope.
Okay.
You know what I'd like to do, though? And like, one last thing.
Sure.
This is like, and I want to give you an example. And this is, okay, so say, remember our encounter phase. Hero, mm-hmm, encounter, I'm sorry, upkeep, encounter, hero, monster. You always draw the counter card. So check that. See the little picture there? Remember, all this stuff will have pictures on it. So roll the d6 for selecting a hero in the placement order for this event. Now the placement order is, remember your 6 heroes? When you put those heroes down, you don't move those heroes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it goes from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, the card's going to tell you what hero is going to have to deal with this event. Hero, from down the corridor, you see 3 ravaged undead rambling towards you. Take the D8. The undead are represented by the red, black, and green D6. Choose which undead to combat first. Roll the D8 and 1D6 together. Highest roll inflicts 1 damage. So the thing is, this is a little event that could happen. There's 3 ravaged undead, and it's like a little combat battle. And if you get to the end, you know, it's a fight to the death. So the thing is, it's like fun little, you know, events and encounters like this. And that's why I really wanted to show you that I had a fun time creating these, and I want to create more for you.
Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to share one of those. This one here, rats could come out. You know, you have to, you know, fight off these rats. Whatever happen, whatever you imagine in a dungeon, mm-hmm. I assure you, it will happen in Dungeon Crusade. And then there's the last thing is there is whatchamacallit. Oh, someone asked about this. See the spike floor?
Yeah.
You're gonna take a token and put that on the floor. Any hero going over that, you're gonna have to do an attribute test. Mm-hmm. Look at this. They found a beautiful fountain, a healing water. And if heroes are, you know, if you need health, you can drink from it. And right, real quick, see these symbols right here? It's like a yellow eye and a red. That simply means if you're engaged in combat, you cannot partake in this event. And yellow means if you're being tracked by a guardian, you cannot partake in this. So if you have any of those, you know, going on, which is really easy to see, you can't drink from the fountain. So it's just little things like that that I threw in for you. Mm-hmm. So that tells you a little bit about that.
Okay, so one of the most important questions that we have is, when is this Kickstarter going to relaunch so everybody can get on board here?
And I'm going to tell you what we have to do. I nailed down shipping today. Okay. We got that taken care of. You think I could try to, I hate messing up my dungeon. I really do. Look at that. The heroes are,
It's perfectly fine. You just spent an hour and a half explaining this game. And a matter of fact, I put the camera on me for a little bit, you know, because I am a camera hog.
Okay. My board's, okay. I'm back.
Okay.
So this is what I want to do. And this is what people are outcrying for is this rule book. Guys, it's probably gonna be 12 to 14 pages. Hopefully I showed you, the game's not complex. There's just a lot of stuff to it. I want to launch this Kickstarter like tomorrow, you know, but we have to get some kind of rules in order. And I'm going to be honest, it's going to be probably a Google Doc. And it's just going to be like kind of what we talked about tonight. Of course, you know, touching on everything. And just to reassure people and make them feel comfortable with that. I want to relaunch. I would love to do it tomorrow, to be honest. But, you know, David's got to build the page. And, yes, I'm not going to go near a Kickstarter page. I'm done with that.
So why don't we ask David. David, when are you planning to get this relaunched so people can start looking for it? And we'll wait for David to...
I would say in a matter of 2 weeks.
In a matter of 2 weeks? Okay.
I would say, yeah, less than that. Because all we have to do is... really have David build up the Kickstarter page. I'm, you know, providing the artwork for it, or, you know, the decorate it. And then we just got to knock out this rule book. We have shipping nailed down. And that's something I want to tell you too about shipping. I got a lot of heat for this, which, you know, I'm a nice guy. And I talked to Jason today, and you know what he told me, Rob? Uh-huh. That I said, I put at the end of the Kickstarter, which I believe I had this right, because I researched it. Uh-huh. And yes, this is EU friendly and Canada friendly. Cause that's what I'd say. I fought for that. And I got that. And you guys will, it'll be EU friendly. I said to Jason, I put that on the bottom of the Kickstarter. I said, shipping will be calculated at the end of the campaign. And a few guys over there attacked me like I was like an ogre.
That's a big sore spot with, and I hear this from a lot of the guys on the Dice Tower and some other people, that shipping, you know, after maybe you dish out $500, then you've got to pay shipping on top of that. You know, sometimes that's kind of hard to swallow when you get to calculate it. So that's kind of been kind of a weird thing with Kickstarter, at least from what I've heard.
But I want to say this because, I mean, I hope people see how I am. The reason I did that, I really got jumped on by a few people. But the thing is, guys, I don't want to put worldwide shipping to wherever, $50, because you know why? I could shoot you in the foot and you don't have to pay that much. I mean, definitely, maybe we shot ourselves in the foot. But Jason reaffirmed, Roger, what you did was right. Why were they jumping on you? You're being honest to say you're charging exact shipping. Mm-hmm. What do you want? I mean, I'm doing the best I can. We don't know the weight, too. We don't know the weight of it.
Yeah, it'll be fine. And plus, you really don't know. And you don't know how much this thing is going to weigh.
You know? I'm guessing 4 to 5 pounds.
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking more 6 to 8, somewhere in there.
That's really heavy. I don't know.
That's fine.
David actually told, and I put this to my production manager at Wingo. I asked her if they could weigh out each individual board. You know, I have all on the quote sheet, it has the, what is it, 400 GSM, or, you know, it has everything. But I'd like to get that, which was a brilliant idea of David, to get the weight of all the items. So we
we could say, okay, we kind of guesstimate. But Ship Layer told me we're gonna be, you know, logical about it. If someone's in Asia, well, we're gonna send these over to Asia. So, you know, it keeps the shipping down. And they reassured me of this today. I talked to them right before I got on with you. That's why I was kind of late. I was on the phone with Shipware for like an hour and a half talking to them about all this.
You know, again, Roger, you know, it's a pleasure to have you here.
And, it was nice being here. I love being here.
You know, everybody gets to see what an honest guy you are. And, you know, like I said, I'm not a Kickstarter guy. And I'm going to tell you right off, okay? I'm really happy to see that you're getting a good response. And unfortunately, you can't see all these wonderful comments that people are saying. David, I'm sure, will pass along a lot of what went on. And he did. David, thank you so much for doing a great job.
Wait, one last thing before I forget. I just want to thank everyone for your time. I mean, truly, your time is valuable. And looking at all this, and from day one, I said, I'm doing this for people. And to give you something truly different. Not like flipping dungeon tiles, which I love them. I wanted to give people something new to embrace and love. And the biggest thing is create. Use your imagination and your creativity and think of quests and share them. That's what I wanted to say. And I just wanted to say thank you for everyone for your comments. So hopefully I'll see you. And I wish you guys the best. And let's do this and let's bring this into the world and enjoy it together.
There you go. So I want to thank you for your time. I want to thank everybody for coming by. Roger, stay on the line for a minute, and let me just close this out real quick. I hope we answered all your questions, everybody. If you have any further questions, put them in the comments once this video goes up. I'm sure Roger will be checking us and he'll answer any questions that you have, especially for the people that will probably see this later on and go through this. Roger, great job. And
thank you.
Like I said, I'm going to try to do something like this every week if I can. If not, you know, what we do is, you know, we're going to do the best we can to try to help you out. And any kind of information or anything, get it to me and I'll make sure I'll convey it to the community. And we'll do our best to make sure that you become successful. And that's what this really is about.
Remember, this isn't not my dream. This is not my dream. This is everyone's dream who wanted this. And I mean, I'm not just saying that as a slogan. I mean, yeah, I conceived it, but you know what? I couldn't have done this without people. I could never have brought this to market without people. So it's their dream too, to have something like this. And I mean, I hopefully you see I'm genuine about it. I mean, so that's, I just want to say that too.
There you go. All right, everybody. You have a good night. David, thank you for moderating. It was a big help. And it gave Roger time to talk everything up. And we'll see you guys tomorrow as I'm painting Rebellion and modding that game up big time. So join me for my usual little paint. You can catch it on the Dice Tower and you can catch it here. Until next time, I'm Rob Warren. Roger, why don't you say goodbye?
Peace. Take care, everyone. Thanks for your time.
Everybody,
I am the self-proclaimed king of Dungeon Crusade. Of Dungeon Games. I want to say that. I'm sorry. You cannot take my crown until you top this. I got to put that out there. And then Rob gets it. He's my successor.
You were definitely the most energetic. Let's put it that way. All right. Take it easy, fellas. Hang on for a minute, Roger.